Unlike the Galaxy S23 series, which used Qualcomm chipsets for all variants, the Galaxy S24 series went back to a mixed approach where, except the S24 Ultra, all base S24 and S24 Plus models not from the US run on Samsung's new Exynos 2400 chipset. A lot of non-US users who have had to use Exynos Samsung phones in the past are pretty worried about this because they haven't had good experiences with performance, thermals, or battery life. There is a ton of mixed benchmark results online about the Exynos 2400, so this video is not going to be about benchmarks. I'll be sharing my real-world experiences using the Samsung Galaxy S24 Plus and let you guys know what I think of the performance on this Exynos variant, including day-to-day speeds, gaming, battery life, and more. Before I get started, it would be amazing if you guys can subscribe to the channel. It might not seem like much, but it really helps support this channel. Okay, starting with just the basics, just like any phone that costs $1,000, the S24 Plus is fast and smooth in everyday performance. Opening apps, switching between apps, and at least for this variant with 12 gigs of RAM, most recent apps stay in memory for a while so they don't randomly close on you in the background. Unlike older versions of Samsung software or some other OEM software, One UI 6.1 is really smooth with consistent animations and transitions all around the OS. The camera app opens instantly and the shutter speed and the image processing are the fastest they've ever been on Samsung. Aesthetics is another conversation, but this phone is one of the most consistent and least buggy phones that I've tried in the past few years, especially when compared to my experiences with Google Pixel and Xiaomi. Even when multitasking using edge panels for split-screen multitasking or multiple pop-up windows, this phone never slowed down or heated up. And I use multitasking pretty often for filling in passwords, looking up something, or using my social apps while watching YouTube. Multitasking is a bit more of a power user use case, but even considering that, I'm more than satisfied with the general day-to-day performance here. I also found no issues in terms of Wi-Fi connectivity, network speeds, and the switching between LTE and 5G has been pretty seamless from my experience. Then, lightly touching on Samsung DeX performance, which you probably know gets you a desktop-like environment when connecting your Galaxy phone to your TV or monitor. With a wireless connection, there's sadly still a ton of delay and hasn't changed much since it first launched. But the good news is the Galaxy's wired DeX performance has been really fast and powerful for multitasking and getting some real work done fast. The UI might not have changed much, but the performance is really the best it's ever been. But that also really depends on what kind of cables you're using to connect your phone to the monitor. So for that, I really recommend a high-quality set of cables like Ohi's The Future cable set, the sponsor for this video. It's a really cool modular USB 4 cable set with power delivery 3.1 capability, and it might be the only set of cables you might need from this point forward for everything you do. The set gets you a USB-C to USB-C cable, USB-A to USB-C cable, a 2.8 feet extension, and a nice carrying case. These cables can get you 40 gigabits per second of data transfer, which not only means you can transfer a massive amount of files, videos, movies, and photos super fast, it also means up to 8K 60Hz display connection. The USB world is super complicated for getting reliable, highest resolution connections, so you can be assured that these cables will get you the best of the best. This applies for audio too, so you're not just getting super high resolution video, you're getting really good audio too. So yeah, absolutely no problem for Samsung DeX, but it's also perfect for your gaming or video editing PC rig or your multi-monitor work from home setup. With power delivery 3.1, it also allows up to 240 watts of super fast charging, so you can definitely rely on these cables for any of your tech with USB power adapters. When I say you can rely on these, I really mean it. These cables have eMarker smart chips inside for stable voltage and currents when connected, not only protecting you, but your devices too. This also helps lessen battery degradation for your phone, laptop, or any mobile device. So if you're planning on using your tech for a while and you want some really reliable, ultra-fast cables that can do it all, I really recommend clicking the link below and checking out Ohi's The Future cable set. Then let's talk some basic video editing, which isn't really a power user thing anymore since everyone's making TikToks or Instagram reels on their phones. In terms of importing, scrubbing, cutting, and applying effects and transitions on CapCut, I found little to no differences in speed or responsiveness when compared to even the latest Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 inside the Xiaomi 14. The only area where I did see a bit of a difference was in the export times. With the same project and source files, the S24 Plus did seem to export noticeably slower, around 30% slower compared to the Xiaomi 14. That is a noticeable difference, but at the same time, at least for short form content, it's a couple of seconds, which is a really minor difference. I personally don't mind that the S24 Plus exports a few seconds behind its competitors for export times, but it is worth keeping in mind if you make a lot of videos or if you edit longer form content on your phone, which will widen the export time gap even further. Okay, moving on to gaming, which is where Samsung claims the Exynos 2400 to be on par or actually have the advantage in terms of GPU compared to the top competition. This is also helped by Samsung's 1.6 times bigger vapor chamber inside the S24 Plus. If we are looking at the S24 Plus by itself, I do believe them. This phone handles all the games I throw at it with max graphics at consistent high frame rates, including Genshin Impact and COD Mobile. For the most demanding games like Genshin Impact with a 60 FPS cap, the S24 Plus was hovering around 50 to 60 frames per second. I did feel it getting pretty warm, almost hot on the left back side after 10 minutes of gameplay. The performance wasn't affected too bad though, and the phone cooled down after about 3 minutes of leaving it alone. This overheating didn't happen every time though, and compared to the Xiaomi 14, I felt that the occurrence was about the same. Keep in mind that all these graphically demanding games are actually less optimized for Exynos. Developers are mostly optimizing for the more widely used Snapdragon chipset. So the performance we're seeing here is actually pretty impressive, and 99% of people will be very satisfied with gaming on this phone. But when placed side by side with a Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 phone, you do start to see some differences. Because of the lack of optimization, you'll notice that the Galaxy experiences slightly more graphical bugs like texture tearing or a few elements not rendering as well. Game loading times between these two phones are actually really similar, but where you see the difference is in the average frame rate. If you really peep, you can notice that the Xiaomi 14 is just slightly smoother most of the time, and the textures, shadows, and lighting ever so slightly look better too. Just like the video export times from earlier, it is a difference, but not a super noticeable difference. And most people will be satisfied with Samsung's gaming performance. Okay, now onto battery life and power efficiency. The S24 Plus comes with a 4900 mAh battery, but it did struggle a little bit in the first week or so to get me through a full day. It was draining pretty fast whenever I was using GPS or was watching TikToks, but after about 2 weeks of learning my daily usage, Exynos and One UI were able to optimize, and now I'm getting a full day of battery life no problem on both casual weekdays and busy weekends. The screen on time really varies from person to person, but for me, I'm getting about 5 to 6 hours of pretty heavy use, which is actually great for me. Really, the only phone that's notably beat this in the recent months is the Nothing Phone 2, which has an older Snapdragon 8 Plus Gen 1 processor. I was also very satisfied with the standby time. Even with just 10% left and you forget to charge it overnight, it will definitely survive the night for you to charge it in the morning instead. So for those of you that were worried about Exynos and battery life, there's no need to worry here. Okay, so putting everything together, the global version of the Galaxy S24 Plus with Exynos 2400 is actually a great performer, and people do not need to be concerned about this version of the Galaxy S24 series. Those famous issues about thermals, battery life, and power efficiency on previous Exynos phones seem to be solved now. I've been experiencing good battery life and had no noticeable issues during my daily use from light to heavy usage days. When put side by side with the Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 phone, the only differences I saw were in video export times and in graphically heavy games. Even then, the differences were minor. So in my opinion, Exynos is good this year, and I really hope to see this trend continue. That's my take. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments. If you like this video, make sure to like and subscribe to the channel. It really helps me out. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys on the next video.